You know, the first story you hear about epidemiology is John Snow and surveying wells and infection of, I think it was cholera in London. And what he found was that one central well was infecting a lot of different people in these neighborhoods. Well, in SPD, you have the luxury of kind of owning the well. That's a curse and a blessing, because whenever you bring something down to your decontam area, you're introducing the risk of infection.
Public health. It's on everyone's mind these days, from hand washing to emerging pathogens. Welcome to Transmission Control, an infection prevention podcast focused on your appetite for trailblazing thought, discussion, and innovations that will help you make informed decisions. Each episode, we speak with public health experts and safety champions from across the globe as they share their experiences, passion, and opinions. From investigative journalism to medical publications, we tackle real-world barriers to halting the spread of disease. Whether you are tuning in for education, inspiration, or to hear the stories that need to be told, thank you for joining us. And now, get ready to blast off with your weekly injection of insight on Transmission Control.
This week on Transmission Control, we are speaking with Garrett Hollembeak, Manager of Sterile Processing for Cincinnati Children's Hospital. And Larry, I recently had a chance to speak with Garrett for an interview on one of our sister podcasts, and he brings a very unique perspective and background to the table and when managing sterile processing. And it's one that probably many of our listeners have in common, which is a background in public health and epidemiology. And his approach to the department was what really stood out to me. And I thought, what a great guest he'd be on Transmission Control.
Yeah, I wonder how many other facilities may be adopting the paradigms that you're discussing, but we'll find out. And I'm eager to hear from Garrett about, you know, SPD and how we're going to apply exactly the principles of epidemiology and IP, of course, infection prevention and quality assurance, maybe quality control, root cause analysis, and how we can make SPD more data-driven. I have a lot of questions for him on that, and I'm eager to hear the answers and to try to get some insight on how we move from central supply in years past to point-of-use processing, where everything kind of shifted upstairs, and now we're all starting to shift back downstairs. And so as we do that, we know we have to bring a lot of tools along with us so we don't repeat some of the errors we did 20 years ago. And so it's going to be really interesting to hear his answers to all of my questions.
All right, we're going to be right back. Garrett Hollembeak up next. Stay with us. I'm Justin Poulin.
And I'm Dr. Lawrence Muscarella.
From 17 Studios, let's get into it. This is Transmission Control.
Joining us now is Garrett Hollembeak, Manager of Sterile Processing for Cincinnati Children's Hospital. And Garrett, we recently got introduced because you came on one of the other podcasts on the network and you were telling me about your background. And I thought, what a great fit for Transmission Control, and especially some of the ways that you would apply the investigation process and root cause analysis. I knew it would be of great interest to Larry as well. So I'm excited to have you on today and appreciate you coming on to the show.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for having me on. This is exciting. It's not very often that I get to talk about both the work area overlap of sterile processing and then the educational overlap of epidemiology and public health. So it's always a neat opportunity.
Well, sterile processing is an area that I think more and more infection preventionists are getting involved in, and we'll even talk about that. But reporting structures have changed. I've seen sterile processing begin to report to infection prevention rather than the OR or materials management, which was kind of what was going on in the past. And we've gotten a lot of interest in getting education for IPs around sterile processing. And sometimes it's an uncomfortable area, just surgical services in general, depending on an IP's background. And obviously they're covering the entire hospital, not just one area. But there's a lot of focus based on the change in reimbursement from over a decade ago in surgical services as well, due to the reimbursement model changing. And as a result, when we were talking to you on the other show, you said, I have got this public health background and I bring a real epidemiological approach to how I do things in sterile processing. And I thought, you know, I've known a lot of I've known a lot of sterile processing people grow into IP roles, but I haven't known a lot of people to come into sterile processing with your background. And so maybe you could just talk a little bit about that public health background and how you found your way to sterile processing to start.
Yeah, absolutely. So I don't say my first exposure to anything public health related in a hospital setting came, worked with a guy who sat on a board of our county hospital. And so I had the opportunity to go and shadow the hospital and see a bunch of different areas. And as part of that, one of the folks I was shadowing and interviewing gave me a book called Unaccountable. And it was about transparency and in healthcare and being, you know, transparent from a hospital perspective of medical mistakes, infections, that type of. So if you were to talk about a spark into public health, that would be it. And so I've been pursuing a public health degree for the past few years and working in sterile processing at the same time. And one of the unique opportunities that gives you is to say, all right, well, I'm learning about these data-driven ways to view things. I'm learning about how to understand prevalence, how to understand root causes. And now I also get to see that in real time in my department. So I can see, well, what IFU step did we not follow perfectly? And how does that manifest as now a patient safety concern?
So as you, I love that, the real world application of your education simultaneously. I think there's an immense amount of value in that in terms of being able to take what you're learning and really remember it and put it into practice. I just think you're going to have a lot more of it that's still in your mind, you know, as you continue your career. I think that's, you know, really a good way to go about education, especially these days. Now, when you got into sterile processing, what were some of the things and your initial observations regarding surgical services? Because I do think it probably wasn't really your comfort level, and now here you are the manager.
Yeah. Yeah. So it is new, and sterile processing, surgical services in general, it's a whole different world. And I think that's one of the factors that can make infection preventionists and public health folks a little shy about it is when you come in and we're talking about, well, that's the sterilizer, that's the ultrasonic, that's this is what we're doing here. And how does that fit into an epidemiological framework? So one of the ways to view that is if your facility is doing 100 cases a day, you're dealing with a population of about 35,000 people in a year. Now, I'm in Ohio, so that's about the size of the city Mason, a little bit north of here, Cincinnati. So, you know, the epidemiological side of your brain says, well, that's a population. That's a whole city that I'm looking at. And what factors are common for good outcomes? What factors are common for negative outcomes? So overlaying the public health implications of what we do in sterile processing was definitely an eye-opener coming into the surgical services side of it.
So when you come into a new role like that and you're not feeling comfortable, one thing I know is the best thing to do is to focus on the areas where you're strong and then make sure that you are leaning on everybody around you and resources outside of the organization to grow where you have gaps in knowledge. But what were some of the strengths that you brought to the table from your background in epidemiology and public health through your schooling?
Yeah, so data-driven approach. That's if someone tells you, oh, I'm learning about epidemiology, you know, you may think it's okay, we're talking about disease and spread of disease. What they don't tell you is you're going to have to learn 9 different databases and 3 coding languages. And, you know, that's all going to be part of your training for this. Now, where you bring that strength into SPD is being able to evaluate large amounts of data and get the answers that you need to. Sterile processing is a data heavy area, but we're not often driving at an overall conclusion using that data.
Okay, Garrett, so you were talking about from your public health perspective in epidemiology. I'm curious of how the SPD or the sterile processing and distribution in your facility, what was that like before you got there? And then when you got there and you started applying kind of these new or maybe slightly different perspectives of epidemiology being very data-driven. For example, what was different or what have you, from your perspective, what were you able to change that maybe other hospitals might be in kind of an older mode, might want to hear you know, in the real world, you have these new perspectives. It's data driven. Can you give an example of where we were prior to you arriving and now after you've arrived, what has changed?
Yeah, thank you. So I would say the biggest change has come in the technology and the IFU compliance. One of the biggest stops to progress in SPD is you may be limited by what your department can get. And that's where having, again, knowing the numbers behind things, where we say, all right, we need a new, we'll just say a scope drying cabinet. And this is why. So because I understand the chain of infection, and I know that scopes with residual moisture lead to higher risk of infection in, let's say, bronchoscopes and patients. You know, everybody that we see is a susceptible host, especially in a children's hospital. So now we use that information to go to our value analysis team and we say, we need this piece of technology because it's making patients safer. And then on the back end, on the sterile processing side, now we have to ensure, and from a management perspective as well, that we're following every bit of information that goes along with this technology. So if our goal is to have safe, dry scopes, yes, we have to have the right technology, but then we also have to build in the compliance processes for our team.
So am I hearing that maybe prior to arriving, infection preventionists and maybe some of the other people in terms of risk management, maybe for example, also were not so involved in SPD and that you were able to bring them into SPD. So we have epidemiologists, we have infection preventionists working with you more now than they were. So that now it being more data driven, you can actually kind of demonstrate a reduction in at least the risk of infection. Is that what I'm kind of hearing?
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, our facility has always been phenomenal about rounding and participating in the SPD space. I would say the change, and some of this comes from relationships with great team members, is being able to troubleshoot and talk through some of these issues. There's a stigma in SPD when infection prevention goes around that, all right, we're going to cover the problems. We're going to hide that, push that trash can out of the way. Well, what you may not be seeing and what the infection preventionist may not be seeing is that trash can sitting there. Well, now that's presenting a risk because the tech is touching something soiled and then going back to, you know, the tag that goes to the clean site. And so having the dynamic with infection prevention to say, we're a team on this. We're going to meet, we're going to sit down, discuss goals, and then we're going to debrief and discuss what's our next step going to be? How are we going to be more compliant?
You were talking then about kind of trash cans, if you will, and drying cabinets earlier. Can you give a specific example where prior to the knowledge you brought, SPD might have dealt with something specifically in a different way than you are now doing it? And for example, is there a specific example of what tools you have now provided and you started out with some type of a deviation or a nonconformance, you applied these principles, and then you solved a problem that maybe without your skill wouldn't have been solved? Can you give a specific example?
Sure. Yeah. So one, and we'll keep with the scope drying piece because it is such a big sink for bacteria and bad outcomes. So when I came into SPD about 5 years ago, I was at one of our other campuses. And our process with scopes was to take this, and it was nitrogen that was piped in and dry the outside of the scope and then to dry the lumen. You know, on any given endoscope, you've got 3 or 4 ports that are coming out. But if you're only holding that air at the instrument, yeah, the biopsy port, you may not be reaching all parts of that lumen. And then, right. So.
Or all parts of the endoscope for that matter.
Yeah, absolutely. You may not be getting clear up to the control body. So what we looked at, and we looked at a few different vendors, we found one where you had HEPA filtered air pumped in at a controlled pressure. You're capping all parts of the scope before you're starting the air, and then you're drying it for the recommended 10 minutes. And we saw a couple things. One, we saw ease on the staff, and because they're not standing there with a hose for 10 minutes, we saw they had more time to be compliant to other processes. We saw no more residual moisture in our scope cabinet, which was a problem. And then the third thing we saw was a reduction in repairs from our smaller lumen scopes, where they may have had a lower pressure threshold. But because of the size of the tubing and how it was metered, we were able to make sure that these scopes weren't getting blown out.
Because the air pressure was too high.
Yep.
So you bring up a really good question for me that I think the listeners would be very interested in hearing. There's these two paradigms we've talked about, which is point of use processing and central sterile processing, the latter of which you're very knowledgeable of, and probably the former as well. And I remember the days when increasing a reprocessing cycle by 10 minutes, you referred to earlier, adding 10 minutes to the drying. If we were to add instead, let's say 10 minutes to the disinfecting exposure time, everyone was up in arms. We couldn't do that. The inventory didn't support it. The patient flow just didn't allow for it. So at point of use, 10 minutes is a real concern. It really has been. In SPD, correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds as if 10 minutes really isn't that big a deal. You know, it used to be a 2-minute drying time. Now we're kind of saying, well, we'll do a 10-minute time. And that doesn't seem to have any downstream ramifications to inventory supply, to having to purchase more instrumentation to meet patient demand. Can you comment a little bit on those two different kind of scenarios or paradigms, that is the point of use processing, which is so sensitive to time, and central sterile processing, which appears maybe not to be so sensitive? And if not so sensitive, why is it not so sensitive?
Yeah, that's a great way to view that, because you have a kind of a break-even point at the disinfection stage where, okay, we've now made the scope, we've gone from the scope being as soiled as it can be, and now we're doing point of use cleaning, and we're racing against the clock because we're, you know, the pathogens are duplicating every 2 minutes, you know. So, and then we have this peak point with the disinfection, and now we're on our way to the next patient. So when we think of one from a staffing standpoint, rework increases the risk of cross-contamination more than I think we're aware of, or we talk about as much as we should. If a scope is clean and it has to go back to decontam to be reprocessed because somebody didn't put the hang time label, we're actually introducing more pathogens by bringing it down to the decontam or the scope reprocessing area. So there's a value where, can I afford to spend 10 minutes to make sure the scope is dry? Or am I going to have to spend an hour and a half to bring it through the whole reprocessing cycle because we missed a step? So being on the other side of that, you know, critical HLD step gives you some breathing room to start doing things, you know, in a more compliant way.
So you're basically saying then that while you're losing 10 minutes now, you're potentially saving an hour and a half. Seems to be a little more of a comfort zone, but that probably is, though, the other downside to that potentially is you have to have adequate inventory of endoscopes. And what about maybe a smaller facility that doesn't have the same resources, or maybe that inventory is, would you see 10 minutes still being a concern for them? Or are we really hearing that maybe based on each individual hospital, there's kind of an assessment of whether they can tolerate this 10 minutes, they can't tolerate it? So is it really kind of like a risk assessment and kind of a performance efficacy that we're evaluating based on each individual hospital rather than making generalized statements that other hospitals can implement as well?
Yeah, and I think when you read through the standards, so many times you'll see with the use the phrases like your facility's multidisciplinary group, and that's where those conversations are really important to have somebody from SPD say, well, it has to be done this way. Well, that may mean something to the OR. To have infection prevention come in and say, you can't afford not to do it this way, that's a whole different conversation. Because now we have a little bit more gas in the tank to say, all right, let's talk to the scheduler. Let's push a case 10 minutes back.
It's hard to document the rework and plan for it. That's the thing. When you do your calculations, you don't calculate inefficiencies like that in. When something doesn't go right and you have to redo it, it never becomes part of the plan, even though it's just the obvious issue to why the performance is down. Whereas the 10 minutes is something that you can put into an equation and show people that this is the time it takes. And then I can totally see that. And that risk assessment, like Larry talked about, I know you said that was a very big piece of the puzzle that you brought from your training in public health. But I also wanted to touch on another concept. And I remember when we talked about this, you mentioned it, but I can't even remember exactly what it means in the context that you provided it. But I wonder if it's similar to the context of the conversation we're talking about with bringing more contaminants, you know, into reprocessing, which is this acknowledgement of spread or acknowledging spread. Can you tie that into this conversation that we're having right now? Or am I just off the wall with that?
No. It's a good and a key thing. On the back end of all of this work is we want to make sure that pathogen A doesn't get to patients 1 through 5. And this is one thing kind of epidemiology, you know, the first story you hear about epidemiology is Jon Snow and surveying wells and infection of, I think it was cholera in London. And what he found was that one central well was infecting a lot of different people in these neighborhoods. Well, in SPD, you have the luxury of kind of owning the well. That's a curse and a blessing, because whenever you bring something down to your decontam area, you're introducing the risk of infection. And that's why we have to be very cautious about, you know, when something is sent down, does it have a reason to be sent down? How can we avoid that? There's some environment of care cleaning stuff that goes along with decontam that, you know, this is probably part of a bigger discussion. But so when we know that decontam is as bad as it's going to get from an infection control standpoint, how much do we open up risk to patient 5 by bringing endoscope A down because we forgot a step
and had to rework something?
So when you have an issue that pops up, let's walk through the investigation process that really ties to your training as well. You have 3 main components to that you explained to me, which is that needs assessment we just mentioned, and then something that we talked about before, that root cause analysis, and then this concept of leading and lagging factors. And I really want to hear this in the context of maybe a story about SPD. It can be a fictional story, but I think there's a lot of people that are listening that understand this investigation process, but I want to make it relative to the SPD environment if we can.
Okay. Yeah. So when we do a needs assessment, we're looking at, we'll talk it in terms of sterile trays, because HLD, you're going to have some wobble there with patient safety. So we're going to say we're trying to get to a 10log6 reduction of pathogens. And in order to do that, we need to take steps 1 through 20 in the IFU. That's what we're guiding by. When we have a break-in process and we find that out usually by root cause analysis, or usually because something happens in the OR, and then we investigate. So then we go to corrective action. And so let's say, for example, we had a soiled lumen in the OR and a suction wasn't, you know, so then we go into, we can look at that and say, all right, the tech who did that did a bad job. We're going to correct them and move on. Well, that's fair enough from an operations perspective, but from an epidemiological perspective, we need to say that's an incident that introduced risk, and how much is that happening? So if I had one lumen that was discovered and I had 10 trays that were processed that day, how many lumens were maybe up in the OR that, you know, just because they didn't happen to use them that day, we didn't discover them? So we can do a statistical analysis and say, out of, now I'm going to audit 20 trays and, you know, really do a, you could do a, like a channel check or an endo, you know, something to detect for, you know, residual. And those are going to be what gives you your leading and lagging factors. It took me a minute to get there. But so your leading factors are what happened before to cause the soiled lumen. And again, you got to go back to decontam, and we got to find, all right, well, maybe your sonicator or your ultrasonic was not functioning properly, and that's a repair issue. Well, then we take a step back, and was that lumen flushed according to your policy when it left point of use? Now, the lagging factor is what's visible. That's what you get called for when something pops out on the table, you know, and it shouldn't have been there. So we often see the lagging. So the challenge for us in SPD is don't address that lagging factor and call it a day. Don't just say, well, that was a bad, you know, happenstance. We need to really take it all the way back to the previous patient and say, what happened between the start and the end time to really cause this, and how can we address it?
So when you say the lagging, can you define that a little bit? I think I understood what you said by leading, but lagging, is that the deviation or the nonconformance? Is that the identification of the problem?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's the visible, what we see, the tip of the iceberg that, you know, crashes into the ship.
Or the complaint from the end user. Like, it doesn't always hit the patient, right? Sometimes it's the calls down that there's bioburden in a tray, or, you know, something, you know, the indicator didn't pass, like all these different things, or the wrong instruments, the count sheet wasn't right, right? It typically, the lagging factors are represented by complaints. Is that true?
I'd say in my experience, that's accurate. Yep.
And then you're determining the frequency of how often this happens, but as well as the severity. Do you always assume that whenever you find an instrument in the OR that's soiled, do you always take worst case scenario and say that could indeed cause an infection risk, even if it has been steam autoclaved? Do you just assume black and white, binary, if it's contaminated, it's an infection risk? Or do you get into a little bit of what the severity, let's say in a scale of 1 to 5, is it always a 5 when you see debris in the operating room on an SPD, quote unquote, sterilized instrument, always a 5, or could it be a 1, 2, 3? How do you kind of gauge that?
Yeah, I think, and this may just be my personality, but it is always a black and white. We either introduced risk or we mitigated it for the patient. You know, sterile processing, you know, it's a solution generating department. We don't, if anything, we're mitigating risk. And we're operating within an assurance that if we do our job, you're never going to have true zero for sterility. You can have an assurance that if you do your job right, you're making a patient as safe as possible. But I do think, this is a critique of my own field, we do tend to say, well, it only happened once. Well, we only saw it once.
The minimizing. And that's the difference with the epidemiology and doing the needs assessment and the gap assessment is you're trying to identify leading factors before there's ever a lag and being more proactive with the improvement and sustaining those processes versus waiting for the lagging factor to drive a reactive response.
Well, then that introduces the question as to whether as time is moving on and we're moving forward, are we really all in the United States in general, maybe specifically in your facility, are we moving toward this proactive stance, or are finances requiring us to be a little less proactive and maybe more reactive? Where are we kind of heading on that?
You're always going to have a push, I think, for higher patient density. As an industry, I think there's a reason to have some hard stops with how many patients can you safely treat. We know that number is out there. You know, how it's defined or has that been standardized, I don't know. But when we look at airline pilots or even residents, and this is not something that has existed for, you know, very long, but hard stops on how long a resident can work before they need to take a break, how long an airline pilot can fly before they need to take a break. We haven't developed those standards in SPD yet to say how many times can you turn over a scope in a 24-hour period safely. I think there's a good opportunity for that to be investigated as a whole.
And let's talk a little bit about COVID and maybe the impact that it has directly had on workflow and these paradigms of epidemiology and applying public health to central sterile processing and distribution. How have things changed as we move out of COVID compared to prior to COVID and to our being right in the middle of COVID? Has COVID really helped us to dot I's moving forward, or was it a test, a stress test to the system that really showed there's a lot of gaps that we just can't close, or is COVID allowing us to close all those gaps? What are your thoughts of the impact of COVID on what you do every day?
Yeah, I hate to take a pro-COVID stance here, but I do think COVID did require us to look at these things a lot more closely. While working with another tech, and this is right, I would say this was May, you know, of 2020, when all this is coming out, we understand.
In the thick of it, just coming back to do reprocessing after a couple of months off, yeah.
Yep. And, you know, it was a hand wash item, and, you know, we have our own process for that. But he asked me, he's like, well, if I hand wash it, is it safe to touch on the other side with COVID? You know, it was a COVID positive patient. And, oh, now we sit down and we say, all right, well, we're going to look at the IFU. We know that, all right, we plan for everything to be, you know, worse than COVID, but, you know, we don't know that right in the moment. We learn things now about prions and stuff that I don't think we were even aware of 10 years ago. And so it did, in our facility, cause us to take a very fine-tooth comb look at some of our IFUs and say, are we doing this process exactly right? Because now we have a closer to home connection to it, where if I pass this tray off and Kevin's on the other side and he touches this hand wash tray and has COVID next week, yeah, it put it a lot closer to us, I think.
And when you say IFUs, you're referring, just for my edification, you're referring to the manufacturer's IFUs of these devices, or really your facility's policies and procedures?
Yeah, so these are the manufacturer's instructions for use. Yep.
And can you give an example of where an IFU maybe was not sufficient, either because in the days of COVID or not, where you were instrumental in identifying a deviation in the IFU and then coming up with a correction on that IFU that your facility implemented into the policies and procedures, and maybe yes or no, the manufacturer then revised their own policies and procedures, you know, from your insight? Do you have an example that you could share with us?
So as far as changing an IFU to make it a little easier, more compliant, because some IFUs are not written with, I think, best practice in mind, and to get those changed, it's a long haul. But one change that we did make, again, at our campus up north, is we evaluated the IFU and the process for an instrument that was used only in contact with a mucosal membrane. So based on the intended use, it's something that, okay, we assume it needs to be high-level disinfected. It falls into the
semi-critical instrument.
Yeah, semi-critical. Yeah. And there's probably some narrowing of the Spalding scale that needs to happen too. But when we do a deep dive of the instructions for use, we find, you know, there's no leeway there to say this can be high-level disinfected based on intended use. So now as a facility, we need to make a decision and say, we have to be sterilizing these. What's the best way to do that to make sure a patient's not at risk of an emergency, to make sure that we're not delaying care? And it is a process. We've done it on a small scale, and then that allows us to do it on a larger scale, is moving from what we think needs to happen to the black and white text of what an IFU is asking us to do.
Right. And so as we wind down, you're hitting on a lot of important stuff here. But when you're saying kind of a critical instrument then that was kind of requiring you to go to sterilization, I think completely connect that dot. The intended use is the key. So, for example, if we look at a bronchoscope, what is the intended use? Okay, a bronchoscope's intended use is really, it's not entering the vasculature. It's not entering sterile tissue because it's gone through the mouth, which is not what our typical, when we talk about surgical instruments being sterile, we're talking about making an incision and entering sterile tissue from beginning to end. So let's go back to the bronchoscope. The bronchoscope being semi-critical, therefore recommending sterilization. Some have now kind of leaned toward reclassifying bronchoscopes as critical, notwithstanding the intended use still being to contact the mucous membranes. So in that context, can you explain a little further about any type of a semi-critical instrument for which the IFUs or the hospital's procedures would require sterilization, as opposed to sterilization just being recommended and being desired whenever feasible, but we have the high-level disinfection to fall back on at a minimum when not practical?
Yeah, and so this goes to some of the, and bronchoscopes are a great example of this. Laryngoscopes are another good example where you may be using it in a semi-critical fashion, if we want to call it that. But we now have to assess the risk of a patient. And this is where some of the standards of, you know, do we always know that when we're using a gastroscope, that that's not going to lead to a connection with a sterile cavity? You know, if there's a bleeding ulcer, anything like that. Or when we're using a bronchoscope on a patient that is more susceptible to infection, is that now an argument to sterilize it, to make it considered a critical item? So bridging that gap between the highest level of safety for a patient is the headspace that I think is helpful to be in. So it's not a matter of what we can do or what the fastest way to do it is. It's what's going to give that patient the lowest risk of infection or cross-contamination.
And so that risk assessment then seems to be based on patient population. And a lot of the guidelines are going that way. I've always leaned a little myself in coming up with one standard of care, which we practice that which accounts for every possible patient scenario. Maybe that's where you're talking about the benefit of sterilization. It's black and white. We just sterilize. We don't kind of like assess whether that patient could have a pathogen that's transmissible, or maybe it's not transmissible. I think the sterilization model kind of nips it in the bud. But in our risk assessment, if we single out and try to identify a single pathogen that high-level disinfection would not kill, but sterilization would, I can't come up with a single pathogen. When it comes to the instrument design, I know sterilization is better at accessing and getting into all those nooks and crannies. So I think that's an important distinction, that the sterilization seems to be favored because it can overcome for some design limitations. But sometimes I read papers that say, well, it kills organisms, high-level disinfection doesn't. And that's where I get a little confused because I don't know what organisms are talking about. Do you have any comments on that?
I'll reference to a little bit more of my previous background, and that was while working in a long-term care facility. And you see C. diff as one of the biggest risks to your patient safety. And when we, you know, try to parse and say, what's the highest level of assurance for safety we can give this person? I think having that single standard that you referenced is helpful to say, look, we know it's a risk. We know that it's around, instead of, you know, trying to...
You're almost customizing the reprocessing protocol around the patient, right, the individual patient, as opposed to around all the patients coming in, where you won't necessarily know what they aren't colonized or infected with.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Well, Garrett, I wanted to ask you one last question, just because we're bringing your perspective, you know, in the public health background. You know, you talked about at the very beginning, sort of walking into sterile processing, not having a lot of experience, but having this skill set. How would you take your experience and give some advice for any IPs that are out there that are uncomfortable in surgical services and might just not be diving in? Because you talked about rounding with infection prevention now. So I can see where that really allows you to even help them be more comfortable and give them information and sort of work collaboratively, because it is an important collaboration between the two departments. How would you kind of encourage people to be able to be more comfortable in that environment?
I think that it starts with setting a framework for what we're doing. When sterile processing and infection prevention are rounding together, it's not a gotcha game. It's not a, we're going to see what SPD is doing wrong today. And for SPD, it's a real opportunity to use that infection preventionist as an ally to get what you need in the department. I would say one of the most common things when I round with infection prevention is, oh yeah, that's an area we can improve on, or that's a feature that we need. That's a process that we can improve on. And so rounding with them gives you a different perspective from SPD, but it also gives you an opportunity to collaborate with them and say, what is the risk associated with if we miss this step? So we'll say, if we don't change the filter in our AE, in our endoscope reprocessing machine, from an infection prevention standpoint, what's the risk associated with that? And trying to understand that better on both sides.
As well as how often might that occur? It's the risk of the severity of the problem and then the frequency of the problem as well.
Garrett, great job. I really appreciated learning about how you approach sterile processing on the other podcast, Beyond Clean. And then I just knew you'd be a good fit here, and really talking about program planning, the investigation process, and then we dove into, you know, some of your opinions around, you know, scopes and your experiences every day. So thanks so much for coming on.
Yeah, absolutely. This was a great experience to talk with you guys and to round out this whole picture of patient safety. So thank you guys. I appreciate it.
Thank you for your insights.
That was Garrett Hollembeak, Manager of Sterile Processing for Cincinnati Children's Hospital. And Larry, when I had a chance to talk to Garrett, and you kind of noted this after we completed the interview, as we were just kind of talking informally, that Garrett takes a really methodical approach and professional approach to the way that he's evaluating and managing the processes and the operation that is sterile processing. And I couldn't agree with you more. And honestly, there's a lot of folks that get into sterile processing that don't really have this IP background. And one of the reasons I wanted to bring him onto this show was to sort of encourage that collaboration between IP and sterile processing, and specifically, you know, depending on where you're at and what the expertise is in that department, that as an IP, just from the process standpoint, the investigation process, program planning, implementing that, establishing KPIs, and really something that you said at the very end, which is standard work, is really what we're all trying to achieve, because then there's less concern for deviation because the process itself isn't inherent with deviation. And so I just thought this was a great conversation today, and Garrett really brings a lot to the table with his unique background leading into his time in sterile processing while he's going to school.
Yeah, there are a lot of these concepts that he brought up that, you know, those of us on the know are fully aware of, but maybe not every SPD has this same appreciation for what Garrett discussed with us. And hopefully moving forward, this is where everyone is going to go, where we kind of bring in quality management, quality assurance, quality control. We bring in IP, as you said. We even bring in epidemiology and public health, and merge it into SPD so that SPD just isn't down in the bottom floor of the hospital, but it becomes this whole group of stakeholders that are so concerned and so diligent, and all of them working together, becoming so much more data-driven than maybe they already are, and to really apply the principles of public health and epidemiology to what they do every day. And I think it's very rewarding for them. And I think that it's not just the world of biological indicators and reprocessing, but it's much bigger. And I think SPD personnel will find this really interesting. And this is where we're moving now. And this is a great direction to go.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's another great episode in the books. And I do want to remind everybody that the best way to listen to Transmission Control is to download the smartphone app for iPhone or Android. We have bonus content for certain episodes in there. But if you're already listening to podcasts on Apple, Amazon, or Google Podcasts, you can find us there, as well as Stitcher, iHeartRadio, Spotify, or you can just search for Transmission Control on your favorite podcast app. We also really appreciate feedback here. And so I want to encourage you to reach out to us with an email if there was a particular episode that resonated with you, or if you learned something that you put into practice, or if you have ideas for guests or topics that you'd like to hear on the show. We want to hear from you. So so just send an email to info@transmissioncontrolmedia.com. On behalf of Larry and myself, thanks for listening to this week's episode of Transmission Control.